Okay, let us discuss the spectral properties of on-off signaling. We have been, you know, looking at the spectral properties of various line-coded signals. These line-coded signals are used in PCM systems, right? In the last couple of classes, we derived an expression for the power spectrum. Power spectrum of line codes, general expression we have derived, and the general expression is given as follows. In case, suppose if you take the waveform P of t, and this waveform has the Fourier transform which is denoted by capital P of omega, then the power spectrum is denoted by Sy of omega, which is equal to P of omega take modulus and square it divided by duration of the pulse interval multiplied by R naught plus 2 times summation Rn cos of n omega t naught, and the summation goes from 1 to infinity. And here this Rn denote autocorrelation function, autocorrelation coefficient. Okay, so instead of calling autocorrelation function, let me call it autocorrelation coefficient. Okay, and this autocorrelation coefficient of the impulse sequence, and in turn this Rn dependent on the data sequence AK. Okay, it depends on the AK. That is the nature of the data sequence. Okay. So the important conclusion that we can obtain from this expression is that the spectral properties of line code signals depend as much on the pulse shape as they do on the data sequence, right? See, this is the Fourier transform of your pulse P of t. Therefore, the spectrum depends on two factors. One is pulse shape, and this guy comes from data sequence, because in that we have R naught plus Rn. This R naught as well as Rn, both of them depends on the data sequence. Therefore, the power spectrum depends on the Fourier transform of the pulse as well as the nature of the data sequence. So, not only they depend on the pulse shape, but they also depend on the properties of these Rn's, autocorrelation coefficients. And depending on what kind of autocorrelation sequence the data sequence has, you may have a different kind of power spectrum for the line coded signal. Okay, so this Rn, autocorrelation coefficient Rn, in turn depends on the nature of the data sequence, how the data sequences are related. In turn, this Rn is depends on the AK. AK is the amplitude of the data sequence. AK, AK plus 1, AK plus 2, and so on and so forth. So therefore, your power spectrum depends on the pulse shape as well as the data sequence. In fact, you know, this possibility of manipulation of power spectrum through changing the properties of autocorrelation function or autocorrelation sequence and data sequence that we get different line coding schemes. For on-off line coding schemes, we get one type of Rn's. For bipolar, we will get another set of Rn's. For a polar signal, we will get another set of Rn's. So this autocorrelation sequence depends on what type of line code you are using. Different line coding schemes, by virtue of the manner they exploit the relationships between ones and zeros, and which ones are to be inverted and which ones are to be not inverted will determine what the values of RNs. So this RNs depends on the data sequence, how you are going to represent the data sequence. See, we don't have any control over the data sequence, but we have the control how to represent or how to manipulate the data sequence for our requirement. Okay, therefore in turn we'll control the power spectrum of the resulting signals that we finally transmit on the line. So the choice is ours. Okay, so and we will see that it has no very important bearing, and it gives us a lot of flexibility in the design of line coding schemes. Okay, now let us consider the on off line coding or signaling, how the power spectrum looks like for on off signaling. And in the last class we went through the exercise like how to find the power spectrum. Okay, so let me write down one more time. Sy of omega is equal to P of omega mod square divided by T naught, and then R naught plus 2 times sigma n is equal to 1 to infinity Rn cos n omega naught. So we went through this exercise in the last class for on off signaling, right? And now we derived the relationship. So let me write down the relationships, right? So for on off signaling, your power spectrum is going to be Sy of omega is equal to T naught over 16 sinc square of omega T 0 over 4 pi multiplied by, this we already derived, okay, 2 pi by T naught summation of delta of omega minus 2 pi n by T naught. Okay, we finished this in the last class, this one. Okay, refer the last class lecture. Okay, this derivation we already did that. Okay, from this mathematical expression you can notice that the spectrum Sy of omega contains two parts, right? What are those two parts? The first part is a sinc function and the second part is this delta function. Okay, so the first factor of the spectrum is a continuous function, right? We know that the sinc function is a continuous function, and it is a well-known sinc square function, and the spectrum also contains the discrete part. It also contains the discrete part. Okay, so what is the discrete part? It is impulsive components. It has impulse component at different, when you substitute n is equal to 1, you'll get one discrete component, n is equal to 2, you'll get another discrete component. So you have many discrete components up to infinite number of components. So therefore your spectrum is a product of these two components, continuous part and discrete part. Therefore the overall spectrum which looks like as follows. Let me draw the spectrum for these two guys. Because of the sinc function, it is a sinc square function, it is inverted like this. Like that. This is due to the first part, sinc square. Okay. And now I have impulses, and each of these impulses, one impulse is located, let me use a different color, at n is equal to, at this point when omega is equal to 0, and one impulse is located here, and another impulse is located there. Like that, there are many impulses. and the strength of the impulse is constant height, constant. But after multiplication with the sinc function, the impulse height also changes. Originally, the impulse has constant height. If you look at the expression, the constant height is 2 pi by t naught. But the moment you multiply with the sinc square function, then the height of the impulse changes. And therefore, we get an overall power spectrum which looks like this. So this is the Sy of omega. And this is omega. And this point is 2 pi by capital T naught. And this guy is going to be 4 pi by capital T naught. So the first zero crossing occurs at the point of 4 pi by T naught. So this is the continuous part. Continuous part, the pink color is continuous part. And then you have discrete part. This is my discrete part. So it is a combination of continuous part and discrete part. So if you remember, this is the power spectrum of a return to zero signal, or is it return to zero on off signal? Okay, on off signal is an example of return to zero signal, in which we are considering a half width pulse rather than a full width pulse. What does it mean? Let's say this is my duration of the pulse. In this, I'm going to on only for half of the time, and remaining half of the time it is zero. Okay, so from this point to this point, total length is T naught. In this total length, total duration of T naught, I'm going to on the pulse only half of the pulse duration, T naught by 2, it is on, and remaining T naught, remaining duration, it is 0 volt. Let's say it is some plus 5 volt. So such type of pulses are called half duration pulses. Okay, or I can say half width pulses. Okay, when I say full width pulse, then that means you are going to on for the whole duration. This is called a full width pulse. So this is a spectrum which shows the which is the spectrum of half width pulse. So what you find is that the spectrum contains this discrete component at 2 pi by T naught, 4 pi by T naught, 6 pi by T naught, and so on so forth. What is this 2 pi by T naught corresponds to? F naught. What is F naught? F naught is the data rate. F naught is the data rate, where F naught is given by 1 over capital T naught. Okay, so F naught being the reciprocal of T naught. Therefore, F naught is the data rate. And at 4 pi by capital T naught, we have the first zero crossing. As I said, this is the point at which the sinc function touches the zero line. So first zero crossing. Therefore, this 4 pi by T naught corresponds to 2 F naught. Right? So what is the width of the main lobe? This is the main lobe. If you consider the positive frequencies, this is the width of the main lobe. Width of the main lobe. And this point is going to be 4 pi by T naught. 4 pi by T naught corresponds to 2 F naught. Therefore, the bandwidth of this signaling scheme is 2 F naught. Okay, so therefore the main lobe width is 2 F naught. And here, well, I am only including the positive part. In case if you include the negative part also, then it is going to be 4 F naught. But I am not considering the negative part because we are working in the baseband signal. Okay, so I am only including the positive part of it because we are talking of a baseband signal. So in the baseband signal, the bandwidth will be, of course, correspond to only the positive frequencies. If it is a band pass signal, it would have been twice as this much, 2F naught. Band pass signal means the spectrum will lie somewhere else. Let's say this is my F naught and this is F naught plus some delta and F naught minus some delta. So you have to consider both. This is my bandwidth. This is for pass band signal. And this is 0 hertz. But here the 0 is included here. So this point corresponds to 0. Therefore, you are working in the baseband. So in the baseband, we need to consider only the positive frequencies, not the negative frequency. Therefore, the final conclusion is the bandwidth of the signal is 2F naught. Okay, so this is the important point. And I will return to this point in a few minutes. More importantly, we find that we have a discrete components at F naught. See, this is a point at which this point is 2 pi by T naught. 2 pi by T naught corresponds to F naught. At F naught, I have the discrete component. Okay, at F naught, I have the discrete component. If I have the discrete, if I have a discrete component at F naught, what will I achieve? What am I going to achieve in this? Okay, so this is a nice thing, but why is it nice? Because that means I have a specific finite amount of energy at F naught, right? At F naught, I have the specific finite amount of energy. So this energy will be available at the clock frequency. What is F naught? F naught is a clock frequency at which you are transmitting the data. Therefore, the clock signal is being represented in the received signal, and I could use some kind of phase locked loop to extract this clock component for synchronization purpose. And this is a nice feature of on off signaling. But other than the component at F naught, I don't have any other nice feature in this. Okay, for example, the bandwidth is 2F naught, which is a very, very high. Why is it very high? We will see later that the theoretical minimum bandwidth to transmit F naught bits per second is how much? F naught by 2. Okay, suppose if you transmit 1000 bits per second, then we need only 500 hertz bandwidth is enough. But here we are using twice of F naught, 2 times higher. That means 4 times higher than the minimum bandwidth. Okay, so this point we have not yet discussed, this theoretical minimum bandwidth. We will discuss a little later, soon enough. Okay, so with respect to the theoretical minimum possible bandwidth, we are consuming four times as much bandwidth in the signal, and it is not very efficient from that point of view of bandwidth utilization. And that's a very important point one has to remember. And the bandwidth is one very important resource to worry about all the time for us. Similarly, we have already seen not only the continuous part itself has a non-zero value at zero, that is the continuous part of the spectrum also have a specific discrete component. Okay, so I have the continuous component and discrete component. I have at when omega is equal to 0, let me redraw the figure again one more time, it will be nice. Like this, and I have the component at omega is equal to 0. So this is called a DC null. DC null means DC means direct current. So for direct current, what is the frequency? Omega frequency is 0, omega is equal to 0. When omega is equal to 0, I have two components. One component comes because of the discrete guy, and another component comes because of the continuous guy. Okay, so the continuous part of the spectrum also have a component at omega is equal to zero, and the discrete component also has very large amount of energy specifically present at DC. Okay, and we know that this DC null is not a good thing to do. We have already seen why this is not a desirable thing to have on a cable or any kind of line, because this is not good for coupling and all. Okay, so when you design a line code, we should make sure that there should not be any DC component, because DC component will give unnecessary trouble. Okay, we have discussed at length what the troubles are. That is one point we need to remember. And also we could reduce this bandwidth. This is the bandwidth, right? What is the bandwidth? 2f0. We could reduce this bandwidth somewhat by using not a return to zero signal, but use non return to zero signal. Okay, don't confuse not return to zero and non return to zero. Okay, not return to zero means don't use return to zero, but use non return to zero signals. Then if you use non return to zero signal instead of return to zero signal, then we will be able to decrease the bandwidth. Okay, we will be essentially using a pulse width of t naught rather than t naught by 2. Okay, so in that case, what will happen to the main lobe of this? If you go from return to zero to NRZ, the bandwidth will be reduced by a factor of 2. For return to zero signal, my bandwidth is 2f0, that is on off signal. If you go to NRZ, then my bandwidth will be f0. Again, this f0 is not satisfied. Why? Because my theoretical bandwidth is f0 by 2. But anyway, it is much better than your 2f0. Your non-return to zero signal performs better than the return to zero signal. Okay, and again, you know, this f0 is still twice the minimum bandwidth. So NRZ requires twice the minimum bandwidth. Return to zero needs 4 times of the minimum bandwidth. Okay, at the same time, the only nice feature that this on off signal had, that there is a impulsive component at a particular point, that is at the place where the clock rate occurs. So this is the f0 point at there is a DC component. So this will help us to recover the clock. Okay, so I should not really call it a clock signal. It is a clock recovery signal, which will also go. So clock recovery signal will also disappear if you go to non-return to zero. So in non-return to zero, no clock recovery. See, bandwidth is f0, but clock recovery signal will disappear. But this clock recovery is possible in on-off signal. Will disappear. Okay, so that's it as far as the spectrum is concerned. So these are the broad conclusions that we can draw regarding the spectrum. Okay, and one more point I would like to say here. We have a non-zero power spectral density at omega is equal to zero, isn't it? So this is a non-zero value. The spectrum is non-zero at omega is equal to zero, and this is not good because it rules out the AC coupling that we discussed earlier. So AC coupling is something that we just cannot avoid in typical lines, that is at the poles where you put repeaters. Okay, that is at the places where you put repeaters. Why? We need to use transformers. We need to use AC coupling to remove the biases that may be getting introduced by other circuits. So these kind of circuits are bound to be there in your line, particularly the point of location of repeaters, in which case we will have the DC wander and all those problems. If you recall DC wandering, okay, and why do we require transformers? Transformers are used, let's say impedance matching. So when you have DC components, then that will affect the circuit operation. And we require coupling capacitors to remove any kind of biases that some circuits might be introducing. Therefore, AC coupling is something which is just not avoidable. Okay, and bandwidth is excessive. Not only all this, in terms of its performance against noise immunity, it is less immune to noise than polar scheme. I mean, we have not yet discussed polar scheme, maybe in the next class we will discuss, but this on-off signaling is less immune to noise than the polar scheme. Okay, we know that a typical on-off pulse looks like this, right? Let's say this is my 0 volt and this is my 2 volt. This is on-off signal. Okay, so we will have two levels between, let's say, 0 volt, and I will just call this level, 2 volt. Okay, now why I am calling it 2 volt? Now why I am calling it 2 volt is I am comparing it with, let's say, polar signal. Okay, so this is a 0 volt. So I have the polar signal like this. This is plus 1 volt and this is minus 1 volt. So again the swing is 2 volts. And here also the swing is 2 volt. Okay, whenever you want to compare, then we should compare on the same ground. Okay, I would like to compare the on-off signal with the polar signal. Okay, in order for both the signals to have same kind of performance against noise, it is clear that they should have the same kind of amplitude swing. Otherwise I can't compare, right? So both guys should have same amplitude swing to compare its performance against noise, so that a logic 0 is not confused for a logic 1 or vice versa due to the occurrence of a large noise spike for a certain duration. Therefore we should have a similar swing. Okay, and this one is going between minus 1 and plus 1 for getting the same kind of noise immunity as a unipolar signaling, where 0 to plus 2 volt, and therefore this 0 to 2 volt has a swing of 2 volts, and plus 1 to minus 1 volt has the same swing. So it makes intuitive sense, and theoretically also one can show that under this situation, this one and this one, they will have identical performance against noise as measured by, how will you measure the performance against noise? by measuring the probability of error, right? Probability of error. So what is the probability of error? The probability of making a wrong decision from 1 to 0 or 0 to 1. But under you know these conditions, in these two conditions, let me call this is figure A, and let me call this is maybe I'll draw here. Let me call this is figure A, plus 1 volt, minus 1 volt, 0 volt, 2 volt. Let me call figure B. So figure A contains twice as much power as you know figure B. Why? Figure A contains 3 dB more power than figure B. Okay, let's see how. This is on off and this is polar. Okay, so in on off signal, because of the amplitude considerations, what is the energy of this pulse? Energy of each pulse, it is proportional to 2 square, right? Energy is power times time duration. So the time duration is T naught, and the amplitude is 2 square. So 2 square times, let's say E, some proportionality constant, where E is some constant. So therefore 4 times E. Now can you see how this 2 square has come? Because energy is equal to power into time. What is power? Power is voltage times current, or voltage square by R times voltage square divided by R, or current square times R. Let us assume R is equal to 1. Therefore V square. What is a V square? 2 volts. That is why I wrote 2 square here. And instead of multiplying, energy means I need to multiply the duration. So instead of that duration, let me call by T, some constant T. Therefore, energy is equal to 4E naught for on off signal. Therefore, every time a pulse is transmitted, it transmits an energy proportional to this factor. Okay, proportional to this factor 4, because the amplitude is 2 here. But if you look at the polar signal, for the polar signal on the other hand, for this guy, what will be the energy transmitted every time a pulse is transmitted? It is only E. Why is it E? Because the amplitude is either plus 1 volt or minus 1 volt. Okay, so this is my 0 level, 0 volt. Either you transmit minus 1 volt or you transmit plus 1 volt. Therefore, energy is equal to 1 square times E, or minus 1 square times E. So either way, anyway, it is going to give only E. So therefore, energy is equal to E for polar signal. And here energy is equal to 4 times E for on-off signaling. Okay, suppose your pulse duration is T naught, as I said. That is, now let's assume that maximum pulse duration, which can be T naught. Now then your average power, we know that energy is equal to power into duration time. Then if you want to calculate average power, average power is equal to energy by T naught. What is the energy? We said 4E by T naught. What about in this case, polar signal? It is E by T naught. Therefore, E by T naught is the average power for polar signals. For polar signals, because in every interval of capital T naught seconds, you are either transmitting plus 1 volt or minus 1 volt, and therefore you are transmitting energy E. So the average value is E by T naught, where T naught is the, what is the T naught? T naught is the duration over which this energy is transmitted. On the other hand, for the on-off case, we are transmitting pulses only for half the time, because for the other half time we have zeros, right? We are not transmitting any pulse for zero. We are transmitting pulse only for one. Let us assume equally likely ones and zeros. Then half of the time only we are transmitting the pulses, and half of the time we are not transmitting the pulses. Therefore, this is not correct. So average power is equal to half of the energy, sorry, half of the power, total power. Total power is right, 4E by T naught, but you are not transmitting any energy or power for half of the duration. You are transmitting only half of the time you are transmitting, because 10101101100, like this, in this only half of the time 1 occurs, half of the time 0 occurs. For 0, you are not transmitting anything, you are transmitting 0 voltage. You are transmitting to transmit 0 voltage, and here it is, let's say for 1 you are transmitting 2 volts. Therefore, this energy is divided by 2. Therefore, 2E by T naught is the average power for what? Your on-off signal. Okay, see, we are not transmitting any energy during the 0 second, during the bit 0. Therefore, the average power calculations here becomes 2E by T naught. Therefore, what we find is that we end up transmitting twice as much power in on-off signaling than we do for the case of polar signaling. For polar signaling, E by T naught transmitted power, and here 2E by T naught is the transmitted power. But we are getting the same noise performance. So in terms of noise performance, both are giving the same noise immunity. But the on-off signaling needs more power. I mean, twice the power of your polar signal. Okay, suppose we are interested in error rate of 1 in 10,000, for example. For this case, I think the corresponding figure is 8 dB. That is, the recovered SNR is of the order of 8 dB or 8.4 dB. Okay, but for the case of unipolar signal, we end up recovering 11.4 dB. And here it is 8.4 dB for polar, and this is unipolar. I can call unipolar or on off. Okay, therefore, if you compare this and that, how much extra power? 3 dB more power. Okay, which is not a very good thing, because every dB of power adds up to cost, a lot of cost. Okay, so these are the various properties associated with on-off signaling, both from the spectrum point of view as well as noise immunity and power efficiency point of view. So these are in fact the most important features to worry about when we are talking of line coding. Okay, namely power required for a given performance against noise, and the bandwidth used, and also whether it has susceptibility to DC and all those things. So we need to consider whether the line coding scheme has DC null. DC null is not, we don't want, okay, DC null is very bad. You should not have any component at omega is equal to zero. So this one point we need to consider: how much bandwidth does it require, The third point is which one? Performance against noise. And how much power it requires, power calculations. So these are the important points one has to worry or one has to think when he is designing a code, he or she is designing a code. And also it should give low error detection capability or error correction capability. It is not possible easily to correct or detect errors, but at least you will try to detect the error in case if at all if you are unable to correct the error. Okay, and this on off signaling, it has no error detection or correction possible. Okay, there is nothing in it, okay, which will help to become what we call it will help us to correct the error. And the another point is we need to consider transparent to long strings of ones and zeros, and there is nothing in it, okay, which will help me to become what we call the transparent to long sequence of ones and zeros. Okay, if you have long sequence of ones and zeros, then what will happen in case if you have take long sequence of zeros, then you lose your synchronization. If you have a long sequence of ones and zeros, this is called a transparency property. Therefore your on off signaling is not transparent. Not transparent to long sequence of ones and zeros. Okay, so we would like line codes to be transparent to long sequence of ones and zeros. If it is not transparent, what is the problem? Because you will lose the synchronization. You don't know where the bit starts and where the bit ends. Okay, you lose your synchronization. Therefore your line code should be transparent to ones and zeros. Okay, in the sense that our timing extraction circuit should not get affected if such a situation arises. If long sequence of ones and zeros comes, then your timing circuit should not get affected. And there is nothing in it, there is nothing in this on off signaling which will help us to do that. Therefore for all these reasons, on off signaling is not a preferred mode of signaling. Okay, it is seldom used. That's what we can appreciate except for one, that if you use a half width pulses in on off signaling scheme, we get a easy clock recovery. If you have a half width pulse, no problem, you can get a clock recovery. But if you use full width pulse, then you can't use it. Okay, if it is off width on off signaling scheme, we get easy recovery, easy clock recovery. But this feature we can incorporate in other schemes also, as we will soon see in a couple of lectures. Okay, if you have a full width pulse and if long sequence of one comes, then what will happen? See, for example, you represent 1 by positive pulse, let's say 5 volts, this is for bit 1, and bit 0 you represent 0 volt like this. Now in case if I get 1 1 1 1 1 like this, then what is going to happen? You get like this positive pulse, then it again comes down 0, let's say. So it stays continuously 1, then all the problems will occur. Now DC, then synchronization problem, one by one it will come. So this is not a good scheme, line coding scheme, and seldom people use this on off signaling scheme, if at all if they need. Okay, so I think let me stop at this point. In the next lecture we will consider polar signaling. Thank you very much.